Ladies and gentlemen, good day and welcome to the EIT Parry's Q2 FY22 earnings conference call hosted by DAM Capital Advisors Limited. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star then zero on your touchtone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I would now like to hand the conference over to Mr. Nitin Agarwal from DAM Capital. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thanks, Janice. Good morning, everyone, and a very warm welcome to EIT Parry's Q2 post-results conference call hosted by DAM Capital Advisors Limited. On the call today, we have representing EIT Parry management, Mr. S. Suresh, Managing Director, Mr. Suresh Kannan, Whole-time Director, Parry Sugar Refinery India Private Limited, Mr. Muthiah Murugappan, Head Strategy Nutraceuticals, Mr. A. Sridhar, Chief Financial Officer, Mr. Biswa Mohan Rat, Company Secretary. To start the call, I will hand over the call to the EIT management team to make some opening comments, and then we will open the floor for Q&A. Management team, please go ahead, sir.
Yeah. Good morning. Thank you. Good morning, everyone. I'm happy to be part of this analyst call to share an update on the sugar industry scenario, the regulatory changes, and also give a brief on the Q2 performance of the company. On the international front, due to the dry weather, the Brazilian crop is expected to be around 520 million metric tons. It may lead to a sugar production of around only 32 million metric tons. Higher oil prices and ethanol prices are expected to push the sugar prices up. Definitely maximum sugar is expected to be produced out of Brazil. Brazil is not going to produce that much. Hence, in order to meet the global demand, there is going to be upsurge in the sugar prices. That's what we expect the international prices to be in the range of around $0.19-$0.21. The pandemic impact on the sugar consumption is not expected to be so significant. As I explained to you, the raw sugar prices are expected to be in a range of only $0.19-$0.21. As far as Indian crop is concerned, the total crop is expected to be somewhere around 31 million metric tons. They're almost in line with the last year. ISMA has estimated to be around 30.5. This is after the diversion of sugar to ethanol to the tune of around 3.5 million metric tons. Government has increased the FRP to 2,900 for a base recovery rate of 10%, which is a 50 rupees increase over the previous year. The industry has been expecting an increase in MSP from the government, which has not yet happened. We are also expecting very soon the ethanol prices increases for supply to the OMCs. That should be happening anytime from the government. That's what is the expectation from the industry. There is no export policy announcement for the sugar year 2021-22. Another important development in the Tamil Nadu sugar scenario is the Tamil Nadu government has issued the order for manufacture of ethanol from sugar syrup, that is, from syrup and the B-heavy molasses. This will bring in a lot of flexibility for the distilleries in Tamil Nadu to alternate between the ENA and the ethanol production. Coming to the company performance, the standalone revenue operations, revenue from operations for the quarter ended September 30, 2021 was at around 438 crores as against the 529 crores of the corresponding quarter of the previous year. EBITDA was around 115 crores as against the 226 crores of the previous year. The PAT after tax for the quarter was around 73 crores as against 131 crores. The dip is predominantly due to the export quota, which was supposed to be done in this half. Actually, the company had fulfilled all the obligations in the previous year itself. We are also continuously scouting for opportunities to source more and more quantum from the other mills to see the opportunity for export in the future. I'm happy to announce that the board has announced a dividend declaration of around 5.50 rupees per equity share. Another important announcement is about the Bagalkot plant. The distillery has been commissioned. It is of 60 KLPD capacity. Commercial production has started. The plant is operating in full swing, and we have started supplying to the oil marketing companies the ethanol produced out of the the syrup as well as the B-heavy. And during the quarter, the board has also approved a setting up of 120 KLPD grain-based multi-feed stock-based distillery plant in Sankli, Andhra Pradesh. This is to take advantage of the benefits of the ethanol program of the company of the government, and this project is expected to be coming on stream during the next financial year. Also, the another update is on the Haliyal factory expansion. We had moved our assets from Pudukkottai to Haliyal plant in Karnataka. This plant, the final stages of the commissioning is going on. It is expected to be on stream from the end of November. So with this, I would now request our CFO to explain to you on the segment-wise financial performance. Over to you, Mr. Sriya. Thank you.
Thank you, Suresh. And good morning to you all. I'm extremely happy to be a part of this analyst call to share information of the operational and financial performance of the company. While Suresh presented about the industry perspective and the financial performance of the company, I would like to share with you certain key operational parameters in each of our segments. I will start with sugar operations. We operated the plant only in Tamil Nadu for the second quarter. During the quarter, we have crushed about 6.6 lakh metric tons when compared to corresponding quarter of previous year of 5.70 lakh metric tons. The recovery from Tamil Nadu operations has been 8.71% in current year, quarter two, compared to last year with corresponding period at 7.91%. We produced about 0.57 lakh metric tons during this quarter against corresponding period, which was 0.45 lakh metric tons. The cane landed cost was ₹2,971 per metric ton in Tamil Nadu for quarter two, compared to previous year same period, which was at ₹2,850 per metric ton. On the sales, for the quarter two, we did sales volume of about 0.84 lakh metric tons. The domestic was about 0.77 lakh metric tons, and the export was 0.07 lakh metric tons. The previous year was at 1.07 lakh metric tons, in which domestic contributed about 0.73 lakh metric tons, and export contributed about 0.34 lakh metric tons. For the first half of the year, we did a sale volume of 1.80 lakh metric tons, in which domestic was 1.37 lakh metric tons and export was 0.43 lakh metric tons versus previous year sales volume of 2.10 lakh metric tons, in which domestic was 1.36 lakh metric tons and export was 0.74 lakh metric tons. Reduced export sales coupled with the lower release order mechanism continued to be in place, which resulted in lower sales during the year. As far as the selling price is concerned, during the year, we were at 34.76 per kg against previous year price of 34.66 per kilogram. Domestic selling price for the quarter was at ₹34.86 and the previous year price was 34.84, and the export selling price was ₹34.58 per kilogram, and for the corresponding period last year it was 34.27 per kilogram. The closing stock as of September was 1.46 lakh metric tons with the cost at 32.50 per kilogram. The revenue for the quarter was 313 crores in current quarter against corresponding period of previous year, which was ₹412 crores. No cane overdues as of today, all FRP paid on time. And with regard to cogen operations, we generated about 570 lakh units against previous year corresponding period, which was at 521 lakh units. We exported about 278 lakh units as against 287 lakh against the previous and corresponding period, which was 268 lakh units. Average rate was at 3 rupees 34 paise per unit in current quarter against the corresponding period, which was at 3 rupees 28 per unit. The revenue for the quarter was rupees 18.51 crores against corresponding period of previous year, which was at rupees 17.11 crores. Currently, power is exported through PPA arrangement in Andhra Pradesh and Karnataka and IEX in Tamil Nadu. On the distillery operations, we sold 165 lakh liters for the quarter, of which ENA was 62 lakh liters and ethanol was 103 lakh liters, with a realization of rupees 54.55 per liter against previous year realization of rupees 57.49 per liter. ENA was sold at an average of rupees 56.64 per liter. The previous year was 61.34 per liter. Revenue for quarter two was rupees 91.89 crores compared to rupees 85.12 crores during previous year. Distillery margins were reduced as there has been a drop in ENA sales in Tamil Nadu, as it was imported from other states at a cheaper price. As far as nutraceutical business is concerned, the Indian operations, a similar kind of performance like last year, with a turnover of about 21.46 crores as against rupees 21.82 crores in the previous year. On the consolidated level, the nutraceutical business for the quarter has increased its revenue compared to previous year. Turnover was rupees 61.91 crores in current two as against the corresponding period, which was rupees 57.61 crores. During H1, we had a turnover of about 136 crores, which is an increase of 3% corresponding half of previous year. On the refinery operations, the revenue for the quarter two was rupees 350 crores. Last year, quarter two was at rupees 665 crores. The PBT for quarter two was a loss of rupees 15.56 crores. Last year for the same period, we had a profit of about 2.48 crores. Refined sugar produced for quarter two is 0.33 lakh metric tons. Last year, same period was 2.13 lakh metric tons. Half yearly, it was 2.3 lakh metric tons for the current year. In the previous year, it was 3.86 lakh metric tons. Refinery sugar sales for quarter two was 1.24 lakh metric tons. Last year was 2.42 lakh metric tons. Year to date financial year 2021-22 was 1.97 lakh metric tons. And last year it was 3.67 lakh metric tons. The company has been working towards the debt reduction mode on a periodical basis, and the debt position has been much better compared to what it was as of March 2021. The long-term debt in March 2021 was at around 200 crores and currently it is about 101 crores. As far as the short-term loan is concerned, it was 355 crores in March and we are at 102 crores. The finance cost has decreased by about 9.67 crores during quarter two compared to previous year, from rupees 12.98 crores in current year as against last year, which was at around 22.65 crores. We are ensuring tight controls on the borrowings and interest costs. Thank you, and we would keep the floor open to listen to you all on.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Anupam Goswami from B&K Securities. Please go ahead.
Good morning, sir. So my first question is on the sugar cost of production. What is our cost of production this quarter versus what was in the previous year? And also on the income statement, we see that other expenses has risen quite sharply. And what was the reason behind that?
May I go ahead and answer? I did explain about the sugar cost, what we are carrying for 1.45 lakhs metric ton. It is 32 rupees 50 paise. And your second question with regard to the other expenses, in the previous year there were maintenance cost at the plant which we could not carry out because of COVID, and we had to carry out many of those maintenance related expenditures during the current year, and there is one reason where the costs have moved up during this year. And also there has been Bagalkot expansion from first of during this quarter, where the operating costs have moved up. There has also been an increase in the retail sales volume, because of which the transportation cost and the selling cost has moved up higher. These are the reasons where the costs have moved up.
Sorry, sir, I could not get the last part. Transportation cost was higher due to what?
The volumes in retail sales have moved up, because of which we had to incur some logistics cost, which is in parallel with the sales volume, which has increased. But when we look at the overall cost as a comparison between last year and this year, there is an increase in the cost.
How much would that be, sir, your cost of production versus the last year?
Cost of production versus last year.
More or less the same number.
It is more or less the same number. There is no change in the cost of production as such.
Okay. So, sir, in your other expenses, as you mentioned, maintenance cost due to plants and between one of the plant, and also the transportation in volumes. So, I'm guessing that this maintenance cost will not come in the next quarter. And with the retail sales volume going further up, will our transportation cost will somehow the marginal transportation cost will come down? And what is the quantum of this, this incremental cost, which is above the normalized cost?
Yeah, the transportation cost is variable in nature. And when the retail sales volume moves up, the realization also will be better. And we will get our, the transportation cost will be absorbed. But when we look at as a comparison between last year and this year, there will be an increase in cost.
Okay. And sir, what would be our quantum of maintenance cost that has increased in this quarter?
It is more up by about 3.5 crores. Last year, we did not carry out this because of the COVID.
Okay. Okay. This will not repeat in the next quarter, at least.
So actually, Suresh here, you have to take it this way. During COVID times, the maintenance is not carried out. You need to actually do the regular maintenance during off-season in order to keep the plant in running condition. So these expenditures is a year-on-year expenditure. Last year was an exception where we could not even do the maintenance activities due to the pandemic. That is why the only critical maintenance was done last year. This year all the things have been done, and this is a part of the regular operation.
Okay. Sir, just one last question on the sugar side, sir. When do we see a positive margin in this sugar? We have seen the realization has also gone up, and the domestic realization outlook also looking very strong. Can we see a margin of about 5% to 6% as per the industry that goes?
Actually, this everyone is aware, during the period of very less amount of crushing, you are not going to have much of a margin. Definitely the prices of rolling form and also improvement in operating parameters. If you look on the year as a whole, definitely there should be a good picture coming in.
Yeah, the production is more on the third quarter and fourth quarter. The cost absorption also happens during those quarters. And sugar as such will need to be seen on the full year basis because of the seasonality.
And definitely the prices are also looking good if you look at the market. So all things should augur well.
All right. So just one last thing, if you can explain what is the refinery segment business outlook, what are the spreads looking at, and what kind of volumes can we look at for the whole year? So that would be all from my side.
Good morning. Am I audible?
Yes.
Okay. As far as refinery is concerned, we principally saw a deferment in shipment from the buyer. This is on account of a couple of factors which is global in nature. One is the prices of sugar went up substantially in the second quarter. As a result of it, some of the destinations have postponed their buying and utilizing their stock. Second is we also had a steep increase in the ocean freight as a result of which, and also in view of the shortage of container, most of the sugar got moved into break bulk segment. Break bulk vessels were hard to find. So the buyers, even though they have contracted the sales volume with us, have deferred the shipment on these reasons. So the outlook is basically post September, we are seeing revival in consumption on the traditional markets for Indian refined sugar. And we are seeing vessels being placed for lifting the contracted volume. So it is a question of a period catch up, which we should be in a position to do in the second half of the year. As far as the spreads are concerned, on a conventional basis, the spreads have more or less remained the same. And it is a question of the further softening of the energy market and the freight market that will determine the movement of spread going forward.
Okay, sir. I'll join back in. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Kashyap from Telem Partners. Please go ahead.
Hi. Just one question on the power front. The total capacity that we have as far as power is concerned, incrementally from now on, how would it all be merchant or would there be PPA still left?
Come again, please.
So what is the breakup of the power capacity between merchant and, are the PPAs still ongoing or, are we done with, so just wanted to understand how much is the PPA and how much is open?
Yeah, the as far as the PPA is concerned, only Karnataka units are in PPA till the end of December. If you have one of the Karnataka units will continue to be in PPA for the next year as well, it is Ramdur. All other units in Andhra and Tamil Nadu, they are out of PPA. So there is a judicious mix between IEX and the third party. We are already into the process of exporting power to the third party units. So depending on the price realizations in IEX and third party, we always toggle between these two in terms of certain ratios, which will maximize the realization for the units.
So in the Q2, how much was how much was actually PPA and how much was IEX and open sale? And just wondering whether incrementally the power rates that have scaled up, whether we'll be able to take advantage and to what extent we can take advantage.
In the month of July, the power generation was very low for us. If you look at August and September, the IEX was about 71% in August, and in September it was about 54%. On a daily basis, we monitor this and shuffle between the IEX and the third-party arrangement what we have. depending on the IEX rates, we decide as to which one we need to generate and pass through.
Okay, so basically effective from December onwards, only one unit, which is Rangur, will be in PPA. Rest everything will be open.
Effective January.
Effective January.
Yeah. Only Ramdurg will be continuing to be on PPA. All others will be out of PPA. It will be either through the IEX or through the third party arrangement.
And can you just give a color on what given that the facilities are now shifted to Karnataka from next year, what is the crushing we should be looking at in Tokyo?
Current year we are, the capacity of Halyal has been beefed up by almost around 4,000 TCD because of the assets movement from Puducherry Halyal. Already Halyal was having 7,500 TCD. So totally put together, now should be around 11,500 to 12,000 tons crushing per day is what will happen.
Yeah. And just one question on the refinery. I just missed the volume data that you shared. Could you just help me with the data point on the refinery for first half of the year in terms of production?
I'll explain it once again. As far as operational revenue for Q2, it was 350 crores. Last year same period, it was 665 crores. The PBT for quarter two this year has been a loss of about 15.56 crores. Last year, same period, it was a profit of 2.48 crores. On the production side, for the quarter two, we were at 0.33 lakh metric tons. Last year, for quarter two, we were at 2.13 lakh metric tons. And the year to date for the current year is 2.30 lakh metric tons. Last year was 3.86 lakh metric tons. And the sales for the quarter two was 1.24 lakh metric tons. Last year was 2.42 lakh metric tons. Year-to-date sales for the current year is 1.97 lakh metric tons. And the last year sales was 3.67 lakh metric tons.
Yeah. And what would be the EBITDA from the refinery for the full year and so far YTD and PBT for, in your view?
The EBITDA year to date is around 6.44 crores. For the quarter, it was 7 crores, 18 lakhs. And for the 6 months, it is 6.44 crores for the refinery operations.
So, this corresponds to what number last year?
Last year, for the quarter was 21.78 crores. And for the 6 months, it was 35.93 crores.
So basically 36 crore EBITDA and 6 crore EBITDA. You did mention that, there have been deferral in shipments, and I think a similar commentary was even in Q1 that there was a issue about availability of containers, etc. So just wanted to understand that in the remaining 6 months, will you be able to catch up on these numbers?
Thanks, Kashyap. This is industry-wide phenomena as far as the first quarter and second quarter shipments are concerned. So it's basically, as I explained earlier, on both on the destination demand and the freight. Fortunately, the Baltic index has started softening. We are seeing a reduction in the ocean freight charges for the typical destinations of Indian refined sugar. So the contracted sales, now we are seeing a good pace of placement of vessels and confirmation of schedule. So as a result of which, we should be in a position to catch up in the second half of the year.
Thank you, and all the best.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ritvik from one of financial consultants. Please go ahead.
Hi. Good afternoon, sir. Just a couple of questions from my end.
Excuse me, sir. I'm so sorry to interrupt. May I please request you to speak a bit louder?
Can you hear me now?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. On the refinery bit, what is the long-term and short-term debt in the refinery segment?
Yeah, as far as the refinery is concerned, we are not having any long-term debt on our balance sheet anymore. And currently, we have a debt level of around 800 crores, which is primarily working capital. And that will get normalized as, the sales become happen in the second half.
So this is all the inventory which has been piled up in H1, which we
absolutely
are able to sell.
Absolutely. This is a same slide between our production and sales. So this will get the unit out in the second half.
Right. Okay. And secondly, on the, we are transferred one unit from Tamil Nadu, and we had plans to transfer another unit.
Can you speak a little louder, please?
Yeah, sorry. Sorry for that. What is the status on the second unit which we are going to transfer from Tamil Nadu to Karnataka? Any updates on that? Any timelines you would like to share?
The second unit, we are just evaluating. I don't think we will be looking at a transfer.
Mm.
Because you have to look at the opportunity. Last time also we spoke about this.
Mm.
So this opportunity in terms of availability of cane in the destination point was the one which was discussed.
Hmm.
Yeah. So we will not be transferring that.
Okay. So you think that cane availability will improve in Tamil Nadu, so we are not looking to transfer that. Is that the right understanding?
No. I was saying you asked about the transfer of the second unit to other places.
Right.
Not a viable proposition. We have talked about this earlier itself.
Okay.
So this unit, the second unit, will be sold out
of
the plant and machinery and all.
Okay. Sure. Okay. And so in your opening remarks, you mentioned about the Sankli distillery. When should we expect this to be commissioned, the 120 KLPD?
Yeah, this should be for operation by Q4 of
23.
It will be for the next season.
About a year's time.
Regular operation will go for Q4.
Okay. And sir, lastly, on the dividend that we have given, so would it be fair to assume that, with long-term debt almost nil at standalone and even the refinery level, we will be paying out the entire dividend which we will receive from Coromandel to EID shareholders. Would that be a fair assessment going forward?
No, it all depends on the operational performance and the decision taken at the board level. It is not possible to comment at this point of time. As of now, there is a dividend which is declared to the extent of about 5.50 rupees per equity share.
Okay, sir, that's it from my side. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Bhavin Chheda from Enam Holding. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon, sir. Sir, I just missed out. If you clarify, what is the crushing target for this sugar season and for next sugar season after all your capacities are streamed? And similarly, what is the distillery volume target for this sugar season and next sugar season?
See, our to answer the second question first, the distillery capacity is around 294. Okay, so the new distillery plant also has been commissioned at Bagalkot. So next year, the 294 KLPD will be fully operational. The new unit at Sankli will be an add-on once it gets commissioned, as far as the distillery volumes are concerned, in the Q4 of the next financial year. As far as sugar is concerned, the unit of Tamil Nadu is getting moved into the Haliyal, that gets factored in the current year itself. So next year capacity, crushing capacity will be almost same as the current year crushing capacity. the actual volume crushed will be a function of the cane available at the respective location.
So how is the cane availability in this sugar season according to you? And there must be some target to crush, right?
Yeah, yeah. Compared to the last year, this should be at least a minimum of 10-12% higher than the last year. That is there anyway. And for next year, we have to see how the rains are going to be there for the coming years. This year in Karnataka, it is good. Hopefully, we expect the next year also will be around another 10% better than current year in Karnataka.
Okay. So this year, you're looking 10-11% higher YOY as compared to last year. And due to Karnataka unit, another 10% higher in Karnataka unit next year.
Yeah.
That should be done. And so, sorry, distillery 294 KLPD now after Bagalkot expansion, and another 120 would be added to this by next quarter three, which would be grain based.
Yes, sir. You are right.
Okay. So basically, we will be going to around 414 KLPD, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, and what is the capex for that additional 120 KLPD?
Thank you. This is around 92 crores.
92 crores?
Yeah, right.
Okay, and any other capex companies implementing this fiscal, next fiscal, what would be the capex?
See, the overall capex, what we are looking at for this will be about 364 crores. I'm talking about the Bagalkot expansion, which is carried out, the Haliyal expansion, which is currently happening, and with the Sankli expansion that is likely to happen, the overall capex should be around 300 to 350 crores.
300 to 350 crores?
No further project. No project for the projects as of today.
So this is entire in FY22 or spread in 22 and 23?
It will get spread. I mean, a Sankli project will get spread to 22-23 because the project itself will be completed only in the subsequent year.
Okay, so 350 odd crores spread over 22 and 23, 2 years.
No, I'm talking about around 300 crores for the current year and also a spread to the subsequent year.
Okay.
A portion of which is already spent by us as of now, where the capital work in progress is happening.
Sure. And sir, refinery, you spoke of deferment of volume. So now from quarter three onwards, should we be back to 2 lakh ton quarterly run rate on the refinery side? Hello.
Members of the management.
So I'm not sure if you lost the conference room. This is Muthu here. I'm in a remote location. I think the conference room might have gotten logged out where my colleagues are.
So allow me a minute to check. Ladies and gentlemen, requesting you all to please stay online while we try to reconnect the management. Requesting all the participants to please stay connected. Thank you. We have the management reconnected. So we still have the question from the line of Mr. Bhavan Jeda. So you may please go ahead with your question.
Yeah, so my question was on refinery. So from quarter three, will we be back to a normalized 2 lakh ton production sales run rate, or it would take time to reach that number?
You're right. We should be back in Q3 itself to the normal run rate.
To the normal run
rate.
Yes. Yeah. And what are the current spreads like, sir?
Yeah, current spreads are still around $40 to $45. We are expecting, because of what we also heard in the opening commentary, a tightening of global demand supply, the spreads should start moving up going forward. Not the immediate basis, but at least for the fourth and first quarter, we should be in a position to see recovery in the spreads.
And sir, you mentioned working capital debt of 800 crores in refinery. So, what is the balance sheet there? Is it matched by inventory and receivables number there?
Yes.
How much, if you can share the inventory and receivables as in September?
Yeah, we are we'll get back to you on that.
Okay, thank you, sir, and best of luck. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Riya Mehta from Equitas Investment. Please go ahead.
Hello. Thank you for giving me the opportunity, sir. Let us ask two questions. So basically, at what realization price will we break even in the sugar segment?
Yeah. 34 rupees should be the break even for the sugar.
Okay, thank you. And the second question would be that what is the impact of the rain to our distillery, if any? And since we have seen a lot of rain in UP segment, so we are seeing a production loss scenario. So as per your internal calculations, what do you think would be the production loss for the next sugar season as such?
Now, can you please repeat the question?
Can you hear me? Hello.
Yeah, yeah.
So basically, what was the impact of rains on our sugarcane? And the second would be that in UP we are seeing a lot of rain that is happening, and it has caused a lot of production. And the commentary from all the management is that they are seeing a little lesser cane crushing for the next sugar season. So what do we forecast, and what is our industry outlook as such because of the rain scenario?
We don't foresee impact of the rains as far as our area is concerned, our command area is concerned.
Okay, so we don't have any impact of rain.
I'm talking about the AD, yeah.
Okay, and about exports, what is the like total quantity of exports that's done from, you know, Maharashtra and all the west cities like Maharashtra and Tamil Nadu and Karnataka and all together put across in the current sugar season?
From EAD, how much exports you are talking about, or as a country?
No, as a country. I know it is 1.7 million tons something has been contracted. So is there any incremental which has been contracted in the last 2 months?
I think somewhere around 2 million tons could be. That must be an industry data, must be available from ISMA and all. You may just validate there also.
Okay. And what is our outlook on exports? When do we want to export, and what would be our total target for exports, and what would be the bottleneck as such?
I think as a country, I think maybe around 6 million tons is what is a requirement, so that the prices are maintained. With the quota is yet to be announced. So we are expecting to look at if international prices are favorable, looking at the number something similar to the last year, because subsidies are yet to be announced. So we need to get some of the OGL prices to be on par with the expectations. It should be better than the domestic. Then we will find an opportunity to export.
Okay, but when we export, our carrying cost, the cost of carrying inventory is basically nullified. So what would be that cost or the price which we are looking at the export?
I think somewhere around 33.5-34 rupees you should get.
33.5, okay. Okay, and what is, currently we have, as you have mentioned, the quantity of exports, any targeted exports for the full year?
On a FI basis, it will be around 1.3 lakhs.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Sanjay Shah from KSC Securities. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon, gentlemen. Season's greetings to all. So, before starting, first of all, thanks for dividend. And my humble request to the management was regarding sharing presentation before start of con call. It will help us a lot and save time of the management to describe in detail about the production numbers and all. So that was my request. Presentation will really help us a lot. My query was regarding, can you please highlight upon all the verticals like nutraceutical or even first maybe start with sugar, where what are the metrics where we make our production, our sales profitable? Because what we understand is that when the realization is low, we can shift our production to B molasses and B heavy molasses and shift our cane crushing towards that to enjoy the margins from selling the molasses, ethanol. How what are the strategy of our company to make this division more profitable by various means, various understanding?
Yes, sir. Maybe I'll talk about the sugar. Maybe other gentlemen will speak about the other SBUs. On the overall strategy has been, as you have been seeing in the last 2-3 years, is about first is increase the cane volumes for the business as a whole. If you look at the last 3 years, we have been growing in terms of cane volumes. One is the organic volume growth by increasing the planting. And the second is about the unutilized asset in Tamil Nadu is being moved over to a place like Karnataka where cane is available. Thereby, the cane volume also grows up. So adding more and more cane volume for a similar level of fixed cost is going to boost up the profitability of the company. That is one. Second is about the increased production of ethanol. That is what the distilleries have come in place. Bagalkot has already come in place. And we are also talking about another 120 KLPD in the Sankli. So all this, the increased cane volume will produce more molasses, more syrup. And instead of producing them as sugar and selling, we are now putting up the additional capacities for distillery. Thereby, we are able to liquidate the stocks at the earliest. The cash flow also improves. Also, we get a better realization. We also understand there is government continuously works on the improvement in the ethanol prices as well. So keeping all this in mind, the distillery expansions is the next strategy, which is already being in place. And that's what is being worked upon. The third is about the sales. Compared to selling in trade, the business over the last 3 years, we have grown leaps and bounds in terms of our retail segment. From a base level of around 600 tons per month, we are operating somewhere around 6,500 tons per month. So retail sales is about branding. As you all know, the brand is being promoted, and the product is living up to the brand promise, obviously there is going to be better realization for the segment compared to the trade segment. We are not going to sell more in 50 kgs. We'll be selling more and more in terms of 1 kg, half kg and consumer packs. And as you have seen, we have introduced the brown sugar, which is a premium sugar with better realization. Also, we have recently launched the low GI sugar, which is once again a premium level of sugar. So these new products getting into the retail, the realizations also should be going high. So these are the basic strategies in terms of improving the profitability of the business. Of course, as EAD has always been doing, we'll be continuously working on cost reduction across all the places. This is a broad strategy, and we have been seeing the impact of this over the last 2-3 years in terms of the improved performance. And the focus will continue to stay. Thank you.
So my question on sugar itself, so what profit we make on branded sugar as of now?
Broadly, as a thumb rule, I can say that you will be definitely getting some 10% better realizations compared to what you are getting in the trade sugars.
Sir, regarding export, leaving aside the government subsidy, what price internationally support us to export without subsidy of government and make us a profitable?
Yeah, anything around 20.5 cents per pound. So that should be the minimum one. We have to also look at the forex thing. So ultimately, it has to match with our cost of production. Then only we'll look at that.
So anything above 32.50, which is our cost of production, will be good for us.
Now, can somebody help me to understand our nutraceutical business, where internationally we are not doing so great and still we are pumping money into the vertical. So what is the company's strategy ahead on that vertical?
Muthu, you want to take this call?
Yeah, so Sanjay. Yeah. Thanks for your question. So I'll just cover the vertical and, what drives profitability. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Very much.
Yeah. So I think the important products for the Nutra segment, one is Top Almetro Berry Extract, the Spirulina product, and the Astaxanthin product. So these are the three products in that in order of importance in terms of contribution as well to the top and the bottom line. So I start with Top Almetro. How do we drive profitability? I think there is a very important game here in purchasing the berries. The berry gets harvested between August and between July and September every year. So I think smart buying at the right price and buying the right quality will give you a berry which is of a good optimal cost and a high recovery. So that is very important in terms of driving profitability. We obviously have a lot of strong customer relationships on the B2B side. And we aspire to go to more value-add relationships where our product quality and our scientific data is accepted by customers. So the more of these kind of value-creative customers we have, the better realizations, the better bang that we get for the buck. As you know, the Flomentum business is a business we've invested in. It's not a capex-based investment. It's more an opex-based investment where we are building a brand. And this is to take this business and expand it into a business of a 70-75% gross margin consumer facing business. We have good control of the farm and the supply chain, and we want to see it through right up to the end to the consumer to expand the top line and expand the profitability on this business. So that's really the investment or the, I guess you talked about pumping money into this business. That's what we are seeing. When we are actually talking about the international business, this is where the investment is going into. It's too early. COVID delayed this investment and delayed the effort. Now you're starting to see that investment in OPEX happening, which is largely a marketing-led investment. To that extent, the bottom line is obviously muted. We will come back to you as to how this is faring in the next year. I think we'll need more time to focus on it internally. I think the second important product is Spirulina. Here again, we are focused more on the premium segment. We have a good scale here. You will see this year that we are able to produce substantially more Spirulina than we have in prior years. This is because of work that we have done at the plant on efficiency improvement and improvements in yield and better utilization of the capacity. So we've understood that more deeply. So you will see that this year. Unfortunately, we had a raw material impact, a plant-based feed material, feedstock that we used in the process was ruling on much higher prices. We've taken remedial action for that. So I think some of that improvement will pan out in the subsequent quarters. The last piece is the astaxanthin business. It's the smallest of the three products that we have on the Nutra front. Here, the focus is really more on formulated products. To get us better realization. So this is how we sort of look at how to build this business profitably.
So we are spending a few crores on acquisition of one of the equity portion. So is there any other more capex required for nutraceutical business this year and next year?
So we are basically spending money on JV that we have. We just recapitalizing that company so that we take out some debt in that company just to avoid interest costs and then help that company. It's been a slow start to the JV company. It was set up to extract blue color from spirulina, which we already make. I think the market has been challenged by Chinese pricing, which is very aggressive and has obviously substantially brought down the business proposition. So we are working with that, trying to establish some longer term contracts and trying to see how else we could use the facility. So I think this capitalization of the business will help it take out all of its interest costs, settle its debt, and focus purely on the operations in a much more leaner manner. So that's why we've done this.
Sir, thank you for replying my questions. Good luck to you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Gautam Dedia from Nalanda Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi sir. Just one question. Can you just share the branded sugar volumes for this quarter and first half versus year on year?
Yeah, we'll just get that.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Anupam Goswami from B&K Securities. Please go ahead.
Hi, so can you mention the what is our display target for this year as well as for the next year, and what is our target of the breakup, as in what in how much ENA and how much ethanol, and in ethanol how much B heavy are we doing? Because I am to understand that B heavy has the highest margin, and so why are we not focusing more on B heavy?
So for the quarter, if you look at our the sale of 165 lakh liters, B heavy is around 60. I think the point to note here is the B heavy and syrup have to be seen in tandem, and profitability of B heavy, if you look at if it is high or low, is a function of the transfer pricing. But definitely it is better than the C, there is no doubt, and it is better than the sugar proposition. And as the plants run, normally it is better to run during the season when the crushing is happening in syrup, and during the process produce the B heavy, and use the molasses generated thereon to consume during the off season in the form of running the distilleries with the B heavy. Yeah, in our experience in the last 2 years, we have found that to be the most optimum model to maximize the margin. On that basis, the sale contracts will be done. You can also see there is a differential between syrup and B-heavy in terms of the prices. Of course, by and large, you look at the contributions, it depends on how you value the molasses. Accordingly, the margins will be coming in. So the ideal way is to run the during the season to syrup, and so that you maximize the syrup. And during the, because there are other operating parameters, it will be beneficial when you run the season on syrup. And during the process, take out the B-heavy and use it during the off-season. And in terms of the retail volumes, we had talked about last quarter, we were around the retail sugar volume is somewhere around 15,700 tons. And current quarter this financial year is around 19,500 tons.
Sir, what is our target for the going forward? What do we look at? Are we going to produce more ethanol rather than ENA, and in ethanol more behavior, as you said?
Sir, actually, this will be based on the closer to time the prevailing prices of ENA. For plants where we are already dedicated for supply to the oil marketing companies, for example, we have in Sankri, we have in Bagalkot, those things will continue to be going to the oil marketing companies. Places like Haliyal and Tamil Nadu, we will evaluate the opportunity, whichever is best for the business during the time of production. I will be taking those calls and accordingly decide on the flexibility between ENA and ethanol.
Okay, and what is our margin to margin, what is our comparison as in for ethanol and ENA?
It will be more or less the same.
You have to see it on a holistic basis. If you look at this, when you run ENA, the steam consumption for the plant is different.
It keeps fluctuating.
Prices also keep fluctuating. And there are certain operational benefits when you run syrup, ethanol, behavior, ethanol. So by and large, it is the same. It is the flexibility which gives you the advantage to take advantage of the market prices.
So any chance of, you know, having a higher margin in the display segment going forward because of our strategy, any of our strategy that we're looking at? Because right now the margin, as we understand, is quite lower side than the industry average. So what is our strategy to improve the margin in the display side?
I think the display margins have to be seen in comparison with the sugar what margins what we make. So it is a function of what is the realization you get out of sugar. The sugar realizations are low. The liquidation of sugar is also limited due to the release quota. Instead of producing as sugar, you will be producing as the distillery production, either ethanol or ENA. So it is a differential between the sugar as well as the ethanol. And for a given the cost of cane of the particular region, the margins can differ. And similarly, for example, the selling prices in north and sugar could be different, in south is different. Ethanol prices can be different, and ENA prices prevailing in the respective markets can be different. So the margins have to be compared as against vis-a-vis sugar, how much you are making compared to in terms of ethanol. That's how it needs to be compared. Also, as you see, any time the government might be announcing the increase in the ethanol prices for supply to oil marketing companies, and MSP has not gone up, so automatically it becomes a natural choice for us to maximize the ethanol.
Okay. Thank you, sir. I'll join back.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Rajesh Majumdar from PNK Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good afternoon, sir, and thanks for taking my call. So, sir, two questions. Most of my questions are answered. On the distillery side, why is there a drop in the profitability on a quarterly basis despite an increase in sales?
See, there are two impacts which has happened during the thing. One is we had a local lockdown in Tamil Nadu where most of the sales were happening. That during that period, the sales did not happen, and the production also subsequently got hampered because there was a lot of inflow of low-cost ENA flowing from other states into the thing. The ENA prices plummeted, and the offtake also went very low, and consequently, the production did not happen. Hence, the cost absorption, those challenges were there. And now, since subsequently in the quarter three onwards, this has got stabilized and things should start improving from now on.
But the sales has gone up from 81 to 92 crores, 82 to 90, by 10 crores approximately, on a quarterly basis.
Yeah, that's from the inventory what we had. Bagalkot also, there has been an...
And Bagalkot, you've been selling out of Bagalkot. Yeah.
That's an increased production for the current year. Yeah.
So, because there's a 10 crore increase in sales, there is a 3 crore drop in the segmental profit, which I found surprising actually. If you look at the quarterly numbers.
Yeah, it has got to do with the Bagalkot increased volumes.
Yeah, that is TN was completely shut for most of the quarter. So,
right.
We couldn't run any of our distilleries. I mean, that's a government issue. So, that was a huge dent.
Okay, so Bagalkot was operating at a lower utilization, that's why the profitability is low, is that right?
No, Bagalkot, sir, actually, you have to understand that Bagalkot has run during the quarter. However, Tamil Nadu units could not run during the quarter because of the challenges. The government did not give us the permission to produce ethanol out of syrup or B-heavy. On the other hand, we could not sell our ENA. So, since the sale could not happen because of the low-cost imports happening into the state, we were forced to stop the plants. So, since the plants were stopped, the fixed cost absorption has happened, hence the profitability has taken a hit. Bagalkot is running normal, and that has just added to the profits. No issues on that.
Got it, sir. And my second question was on the refinery side. We've seen various issues coming up, like, of course, now this the container issue and stuff like that. So I had two questions. One is that are we getting the raw sugar from the domestic side now with the deemed export benefit?
Yes, since April this year, our sourcing has been 100% on Indian raw sugar basis. So we are procuring all our raw sugar in India.
So can you speak up a little bit? I can't hear you.
Sorry, am I better? better now? Is it better?
Yeah, better. Yeah.
Okay. Since April, we have been sourcing our raw sugar requirements from India only.
And what is the incremental benefit on that in terms of dollar per ton?
Yeah, approximately around $5 to $10, depending on the time frame.
Okay. And my second question was that last year we saw some kind of unusual inventory things happening in the second half in the refinery business. Is that behind us? So we had a 140 crore kind of loss. So how should we look at the refinery business in terms of long-term profitability, which is sustainable?
I think, to answer the first part of the question, those is pretty much behind us. The control as well as measurement mechanisms as well as verification mechanisms all have been improved subsequent to that event of last year. So in terms of the long-term future for refinery, the overall strategy remains the same as we have been sharing earlier. In terms of improving our value-added sales, we are one of those fortunate refineries who are able to sell 100% of its sugar as Barry brand. With visibility at the final market. So from general trade sales, we have been building the books with respect to institutions and specific sugars, for example, sugars for pre-mixed coffee, sugars for solid mixing in terms of energy drinks and other beverages, etc. So that gives us a little bit extra premium over the standard trade sugar. The strategy of the business to increase that into a 20% or 25% of our basket, where the 75% will work on a fast absorption mode. 25 would be a cream with respect to the premium. Since it's purely a commodity business, we also have to look at continuously improving our cost of refining. And to that extent, your asset utilization as well as optimization of our refinery run goes a long way in order to reduce the cost. We have made significant progress in terms of improving our refinery cost over the last 4 years. So that journey will continue in order to fine-tune the refining cost. So principally on a long-term basis, it increases relation to value-added sugar and lower cost of food.
Should
help us to get to the desired goal.
And what is our cost structure now in terms of dollar per ton in the refinery?
At the moment, we have around $35 of refining cost.
Okay. Yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ritvik from One Up Financial Consultants. Please go ahead.
Sir, thanks for the follow-up. Earlier in the call, you mentioned the break-even level of sugar. I missed that. Can you just reconfirm the same?
We said the cost of production is around 32 rupees 55 cents per kilogram. Anything above that should give us margins in the sugar segment.
Okay.
Sugar. Yeah.
Okay. So current quarter, when we are seeing an EBIT loss in the sugar segment, so is this, and you mentioned that realization is 34.5 in the current quarter. So how do we read this?
The sugar production actually happens in the third quarter and the fourth quarter of the year.
Hmm.
The absorption of costs happens in the subsequent periods. So we have to look at the entire profitability for the full year in
on
a quarterly basis.
Okay, so once we are about 32.5 on the realization front, we should be profitable for the full year in the sugar segment.
Yes.
Right. Okay. And so what is the average cane cost landed for us? Across Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, and Andhra, if you can give us that split.
Yeah, we'll share it.
Yeah.
One cost. The average value for it. We'll just get that.
Sure.
Yeah, during this quarter, we have production only at Tamil Nadu.
Mm.
And the landed cost of cane is 2,791.
Mm.
2971. Yeah, 2971.
Okay. And what would be the current cost, like from October, November onwards in Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh?
Karnataka will be around 3,000.
This is in line with the FRP.
Yeah, 400 rupees.
Sorry, I missed that. Sorry.
No, Karnataka will be around 3,400, which is in line with the FRP based on the recovery.
Okay.
Andhra will be somewhere around 3,100 rupees per ton.
Okay. So, and this is all including transportation when we're talking about landed, right?
Yeah, landed. Yeah.
Right, okay. So Tamil Nadu and Andhra Pradesh would be around 3,100 and Karnataka is at 3,400.
Yeah, Andhra Pradesh is 3,200. Tamil Nadu, sorry. Tamil Nadu for the full year, when we look at it, it will come to around 3,200 rupees.
Okay, for this current sugar season.
Yeah.
Okay, okay. Yeah. And so one final question from my end. You know, on the release quota mechanism, so, you know, it seems that we are heading towards 6 to 7 million tons of closing inventory by September 2022, assuming a 5-6 million ton of export happening in this year as well. So, you know, what is your sense that at what levels will the government, you know, give some more relief for, you know, completely do away with this release quota? What is your sense on that? At what inventory level will the government look at?
I think once the stock levels are going to around 2 months equivalent, then it becomes a tight supply.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe that could be a time when the government might decide to do away with the release quota. But that is once again a function of how much the crop is going to be there in the next year.
Mm-hmm.
If there is going to be a bumper crop for next year, then once again government has to look at other revenues, because now the export subsidy is also not there.
Right.
So the exports is based on the international prices and the forex rates, whatever.
Mm.
So if those things are going to be favorable, then the 6 million will happen. So far, they have not yet announced the export subsidy.
Mm-hmm.
So it is up to the mills now to decide on their cost of production, based on which they will decide to export and then liquidate the stocks.
Mm.
So there is no guaranteed program on exports. Hopefully, if this 4 or 5 million tons happen on exports, and the diversion to ethanol also happen, and the estimates of sugar also are happening around that level, maybe next year 6 million tons of closing stock, prices also should firm up. Maybe that may be the time when the stock levels are maybe 2 to 3 months of production, 3 months of consumption, then government may think about the release quota.
Right. Okay. Okay. That's it from my side. Thank you and all the best.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, that was the last question for today. I would now like to hand the conference back to the management for closing comments.
Thank you everyone for joining this call and taking your time out, and it has been a pleasure interacting with you, and hoping to see you in the 3 months from now on a similar call. Thank you so much. All the best.
Thank you very much. On behalf of DAM Capital Advisors Limited, we conclude today's conference. Thank you all for joining. You may now disconnect your lines.